So this panel is on the SDGs. So we're going to have perspectives from Asia as well as perspectives from Australia. We had an excellent introduction to the SDGs, particularly around environmental concerns this morning. A really illuminating presentation, really showing us some of the stark reality of what's to come. And 2015 was a pivotal year as we transitioned from the MDGs to the SDGs. There are lots of criticisms of both sets of goals. Fans of the MDGs love them because, you know, there was only a few. They were measurable, and they really focused attention and resources on critical issues. However, there were a lot of critics, and critics argued, including Mark Malik Brown, argued that, you know, the MDGs were written by a very small group of DAC donors in the basement of the UN, and that they avoided discussion of human rights, and that they really only applied to developing countries, and not really to all countries. So now we have the SDGs, and advocates of them love that they're inclusive, they're rights-based, and they really involved a global participatory process to develop. Critics say they're immeasurable, they're utopian, and to quote William Easterly, who's particularly scathing, he said, "The SDGs are a mushy collection of platitudes that will fail on every dimension. They make me feel quite nostalgic for the MDGs." So my first set of questions for our panel, do you think the SDGs are better or worse than the MDGs from your perspective? You know, what are their strengths and weaknesses? And how influential will the SDGs be compared to the MDGs? Unmi, would you like to start?
Why not?
Yes.
Are they better or worse? I think they're different. I think they're different, and some of the things that you said were the strengths of MDGs, flip side are SDG weaknesses and vice versa. So SDGs talk about new issues that were not as significant when MDGs were announced, like climate change, terrorism, peace issues, and so on. So I think there are definite strengths that it includes some of the newer issues that have become very, very critical in this century. Also, the MDGs were criticized for dealing only with social development or human development, and not enough, once you educate people, once you cure of their illnesses, they need a place to go to work. But the MDGs did not do enough in terms of economic growth or economic development. So they were educated, but no place to go to work. So the SDGs, I think, made a very important jump in including economic development issues. So I think that's an improvement. A very difficult topic, peace, was not going to be on the table for a long time, but I believe at the insistence of Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, peace was included, because although it's very difficult to untangle the difficult relationship between poverty and peace or war and conflict, we must deal with that issue. We must at least deal with how getting rid of poverty can also be a remedy or a small help toward improving the security of a region or countries. As we see boats filled with refugees from various countries, we know that conflict, internal strife like this have a critical impact on poverty, and we need to deal with this. And so for those reasons, I think the SDGs are clearly an improvement. My students and I say, this is not going to be easy for us to memorize. In Korea and in China, yeah, no. Our education is based on rote memory, memorization, and it's going to be a hard sell for our students. We already talked about easy ways to memorize the 17, but it's not easy. We do talk about the five P's, the people, planet, and so on, that makes it a little bit easier to see the groupings. But at the end of the day, I think we must recognize this was the voice of people from around the world. I was part of the process at Rio Plus 20, and it was really quite amazing. Sitting in a tent with about 2,000 people, we had these little buttons that we were saying, oh, we think that's an important goal. We must include that. And we had a poll going on around the world for a couple of years tried to gather all the voices as much as they were willing to be heard. So even though it's messy, that's the state of the affairs, and if we at least identify these as critical issues that we must work for together, I think it's very meaningful.
Thank you.
So more on the positive.
Okay, more on the positive from the Korean perspective and your personal perspective.
Yes.
Yang, what do you think from the Chinese perspective? Do you share
from China's perspective, or at least from my personal perspective, I think SDGs is better than MDGs because SDGs, we know it's universal, it's comprehensive, and also it's integrated and it's transformative. That's quite important for us. Because, we can just compare the MDGs and SDGs. During the period when we formulated MDGs, according to some Indian practitioners, he said MDGs was just like more than 10 commandments. That means the north from the heaven. Just point at the north. You should do this, do that, do that. But SDGs, actually, we know we experienced a long time from 2010, the United Nations initiated the not only negotiation, the civil societies, and not only the North, but of course the South. So for example, Chinese government issued two government papers to clarify, to mention that the Chinese government support a new post-2015 agenda. Although we have maybe have different views, but that means the Chinese government involved in formulating the SDGs. That's one thing. And the second thing is that, of course, we all know that China complemented quite well in poverty reduction. Mm-hmm. But during that period, actually, we mainly focused on poverty regression itself. Now, because the integrated the economic growth, social development, as well as environment protection. So nowadays, in this period, when we talk about poverty elimination, we have to think about, at the same time, so we call the green growth. And also, we will think about how can we fill the gap between the rich and the poor, because also in the SDGs, we call it reduce the inequality within and between countries. So it's a comprehensive one, so I do think it's better than the previous one. But of course, on the other hand, there are some weakness in MDGs. Of course, first for Chinese students, it's difficult to memorize all these 17, and then 169 targets, and then how many indicators? It's difficult. Even as a professor, I don't think I can memorize all those indicators. That's also difficult because it's quite difficult for us to create those indicators. Mm-hmm. And even for those 17 goals, one of it, for example, I think it's goal 12 that calls ensure the sustainable consumption and production patterns. How can you imagine? How can we implement such kind of goal? I think it's quite difficult. So it's difficult for us to focus. So that's why I think Chinese government at this moment, we think we try to translate all these 17 into Chinese national policy, but we should pick up something as the initiate, as the priority in implementing SDGs. That's my personal view. I once again, I cannot represent my government. I can just explain our government's policy to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Julia, do you want to comment from the Australian side?
Sure, but I won't even, I'm not representing the Australian government in any way. These were only my personal views, and I'm not sure I can even explain the government's policy. But I do know confidently that Australian students won't even try and memorise the 17 goals. But if they at least know what they are and how to Google them, I would be happy. Undoubtedly, like my fellow panellists have said, I think the SDGs are a big improvement on the Millennium Development Goals. The MDGs were important, but we knew from the very beginning that they were only a very partial view of development. And so to go to this much broader view, I think it's been very exciting. And I think, you know, I think many of us were very sceptical about this complex process whereby the SDGs were developed, and really, would the UN be able to bring this all together at the end after starting all these consultations? And they did. And I'm still quite amazed. I'm quite amazed at the things the whole world pretty much agreed to, because it's a really, you know, it's a very encouraging agenda. So I think it's a much better agenda. It's much more difficult to accomplish, though. Yeah. So I think we need to think about the fact that, you know, we're less likely to succeed than we were with the MDGs, and clearly we didn't succeed everywhere with the MDGs. You know, I would also say really strongly that the huge expansion of environmental goals, Kitty this morning did a terrific job at talking about that, is a really, really important aspect of the SDGs. But also from the perspective of someone who lives in a developed country, the fact that the SDGs are universal and, you know, is actually a huge kind of culture shift. And I think a good expression of the fact that, you know, our problems are interconnected, your problems are our problems are your problems, and we need to fix them together. So I'm a fan of the SDGs.
Okay. So I think we have three thumbs up. A thumbs down for William Easterly, perhaps, on his view, but definitely hard to memorize and a challenge, perhaps, to implement. Julie, I'd like to stay with you for just a second. You mentioned something about how the SDGs really are universal, and they've been seen as a catalyst for wealthier countries to be more introspective about their own challenges and also to examine their impact on the world around them. So is Australia being introspective about the SDGs, and what are they doing about that?
So I understand that just before the UN meeting in September, there was a whole day cabinet meeting on the SDGs, and you know, now there's this big unit being set up in PM&C, and you know, the Australian Bureau of Statistics is right at the heart of grappling with what the indicators are going to look like, and you know, we've got a group there really focused on the SDGs. Well, I made all that up, you know. So, at the weekend when I knew I was going to have to speak on this, I googled SDG on DFAT's website, and the only thing that comes up is a little description of what they are, two paragraphs, and on the Australian Bureau of Statistics, there's nothing yet about the SDGs that I could find on their search engine. So, but, you know, my excuse for this is, you know, it is early days, and I think the MDGs, you know, it actually took a little bit of time to really get behind the MDGs, to integrate them into our thinking and so forth. But there is a risk it won't happen, so, you know, feel free to write your MPs, write to the Prime Minister, tell them how important the SDGs are and how you're looking forward to a cabinet meeting to debate them.
I'm going to stay with you for one more second. So I want to push you, because yesterday you were saying how you really felt that the SDGs, you know, they provide some leverage for how Australia and China, we'll talk about China in a minute, can really address domestic issues, domestic inequalities. Yeah. And I wanted you to talk a bit about that.
Thank you. Because, you know, today the Prime Minister delivered the Closing the Gap statement in our Parliament House, and for non-Australians, this is the gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people within Australia. And, you know, this has been a 10-year effort, and we're failing on most of the indicators. So, you know, that has to be, you know, and clearly, you know, when you look at our you look at our environmental record and things, there are a whole range of areas in which Australia is not leading despite our enormous wealth. So I do think, you know, and I will believe my government is taking the SDGs seriously when I see them really considering them in the domestic policy sphere. It's not okay that this remains DFAT's agenda. Mm-hmm. It really does need to be something that we internalise much more broadly.
Jan, I want to talk about China a little bit, because we know that China has one of the highest rates of inequality, and trying to deal with that kind of rural-urban divide in China is a pressing challenge for the government. And how do the SDGs bring some momentum to the domestic programs?
Yeah. First of all, maybe you have already known, actually, our President Xi Jinping, he attended the last September summit, and not only just attended the post-2015 SDG summit, but also he attended the South-South Cooperation event, as well as the, we call the Women Summit, and so on and so forth, that we call the serious events. That means he paid a great attention to the development issue. Very much. And after that, with the SDGs in our mind, we can see not long ago, in the fifth plenary of the CPC's Central Committee, in this plenary meeting, we issued a very important document, and once again focused on the elimination of poverty, as well as to promote the environment protection policy, as well as coping with the climate change, and so on and so forth. And also, the Political Bureau also issued very important documents. That means to 2020, China will eliminate, according to China's standard, the poverty, extreme poverty. And I think in 2030, China will try our best. That's our priority, that's our policy, that's eliminating all the extreme poverty according to the World Bank standard. And this time, it's quite important for us that not only we just like implemented the MDGs to halve the poverty, extreme poverty, but also we want to eliminate. And also, we try to integrate the poverty elimination into the three dimensions. Mm-hmm. That means environment protection, social development, as well as the economic growth. And we now change our policy to promote economic growth from the traditional one to what we call the green growth. That's quite important for China. And also, when we talk about SDGs, the SDGs go to not only said that we should try to end hungry, but try to achieve the food security. And in China, I think, during the period of MDGs, although we eliminate more than 500 million, less than, but more than 400 million poor population, extreme poor population. But on the other hand, we sacrifice the food security. For example, this morning, Katie said that Australian people and the Dutch people have lots of the similarity. For Chinese people, you are the same. Why? Because the baby formula is so well known all over the world. But in Chinese people, that's very important because, I'm so sad to say that lots of those Chinese tourists, when they travel to Europe, specifically to Netherlands, they purchase lots of those baby formula, as well as they purchase a lot of things in Australia. And of course, it even to some extent may cause some trouble between Chinese people and Dutch people and Chinese people and Australian people. I think maybe in 2020 or 2030, people in China, because we are paying more attention about the SDG 2, the achieve the food security, then we not only eliminate our poverty, but also we try to protect our people with the food security. So in the future, maybe you won't be so lucky to sell all those baby formula in Australia, and the Chinese people can consume our own baby formula. That's also, I think, part of the implementing, for implementing the SDGs. And then, also, very important thing that during the period of MDGs, China is a recipient in the International Development Cooperation. But nowadays, I think China has already become a assistant donor or aid the developing countries. But the thing is that how can we balance the domestic development as well as international development cooperation is quite important. Even that's the issue in Australia, indigenous people and not indigenous people, you have the gap. And in China, we have a very big gap between the rich and the poor. And when those poor said, when you cannot, even up to now, we have almost 200 million extreme poverty people. And then why we should support the other people? They have less poor population than us. So how can we keep the balance between these two? It's also our duty, our government. How can we persuade our people, public opinion, to know that China have to be more responsible in the international, in the arena of international development cooperation? So that's also the challenge. So I think SDGs let our domestic development becomes more integrated, more comprehensive, and to some extent even more transformative. And at the same time, it also challenges Chinese government as well as Chinese people. How can we accept those new challenges, like from the recipient to a donor country? Mm-hmm. So we still have a long way to go. And at the same time, so we need to learn our neighbor, South Korea, because you have already become a member of the OECD. You know the experience how to provide aid when you're still not very that rich during that period. Thank you very much.
That's a perfect segue into my next question. So we looked a little bit at internal policies and the application of the SDGs. So when you raise the issue of China becoming a provider country or being a much more prominent provider country, and the MDGs, they evolved at a time when the traditional donor world paid very little attention to the decades of South-Southland development cooperation that's been implemented and executed by Asian countries like China, like Korea, like India, for example. Whereas the SDGs have emerged in a new era where, as you say, Korea has joined the DAC. And China, if you measure it in ODA-like terms, is now the sixth largest donor in the world. And as you said, at the UN Development Summit, the Chinese president committed $2 billion with the promises of up to $12 billion US dollars in support of developing countries' implementation of the 2030 Development Agenda. And as well, the Republic of Korea has announced a $200 million program, Better Life for Girls Initiative, which will support vulnerable girls in developing countries over the next 5 years. So I'd like to ask Eunmi first, are the SDGs, are they playing a role in Korea's development cooperation strategies and how?
Maybe with your permission, switch the X and the Y variable around in the question, because when I looked at that question, I thought maybe I will start with how the development experience of South Korea, China, and Japan have colored our own experiences as a donor. Professor Barbara Starlings from Brown University in the United States and I have conducted research. We first started out in about 2008 when Korea was about to join the OECD DAC and so on, trying to understand the traditional versus emerging donors such as South Korea, India, Brazil, and so on. The more we did field research, we realized the demarcation was not between traditional and so-called emerging, different groups of emerging donors, but it was really the Western donors. Australia is sort of on the Western side. The UK, the Northern European donors, versus Asian donors, including Japan. Japan was very different from the other traditional Western donors. So to try to lump traditional and include Japan just didn't make any sense. So once we started, once we gave up that idea and said, who are the ones in this other side who look different? And those were Japan, Korea, China. We were very there are some ways that we were similar but different, but definitely very different from the traditional Western donors. Our research interviewing various practitioners in development cooperation, government officials in the three countries and some of our development partner countries recognized that Japan, Korea, China were using their own development experience and how we used aid as with economic development. For example, when Korea was a recipient, a large recipient of U.S. aid, the Korean government officials had very interesting negotiations with USAID officials. USAID officials first wanted to just give food aid so that we could alleviate poverty first, but the Korean government officials were arguing and saying that, okay, we need food aid to eliminate, to deal with poverty, but we also need the funds to go on for long-term economic development projects. So they had discussions going back and forth, and finally the US government, after about a year's negotiation, decided to let us use part of the aid for our economic industrial planning, economic development via industrial policies. So in such a way, our use of aid has been different. We use aid not just for poverty alleviation, but for economic development, long-term development. Second, we talked about a different mix of development assistance, development cooperation. When China or South Korea or Japan go to developing countries trying to assist, we think more broadly with ODA or official development assistance as only one component. We often think with foreign FDI, foreign direct investment via companies, export, lessons for trade, and so on as a complementary larger package of economic support. So we tend to think much broadly about the comprehensive package of economic assistance. Japan at first was criticized heavily for doing too much for economic infrastructure that Western donors have stopped doing. China is very heavy on infrastructure. Korea is somewhere in between, but we have about half in our infrastructure, half through concessional loans, and half in grant aid. So our aid modality looks very different from Western aid. You can look at the bottom line that says close relationship between public and private sector. So when we provide assistance to developing countries, we're often looking and seeking public-private partnership, government working with the private sector of our donor countries to assist developing countries. Some of these points have been criticized heavily within the OECD DAC, and I've criticized some of these points myself for focusing too much on infrastructure and so on. But the fact is, these are some of the common characteristics, and the three countries at least find very important when we decide to help other countries. So the experiences of our own development have colored our experience as a donor. And finally, let me go to the previous slide. And I must also say that I talked about staged approach to development and also the role of government. Unlike the Western donors, they tend to shy away from government-led development. The three countries have had a lot of experience and have successful experience with government-led development, at least in the early stage of development. So we think that in the cases where the private sector is not yet fully mature enough or not capable yet, that government leadership is critical at times. So we do talk about the institutions, in particular about the developmental state, and how to assist the state to do proper industrial planning and so on. So these come from our own experience of development and our own experience of using aid. So this has been a very important characteristics of the three donors in Asia. So I just wanted to point that out. And some of us have argued that our formula for our own development was against the Washington consensus that didn't really bring about poverty alleviation or growth in sub-Saharan Africa in particular. So we think this is an alternative modus operandi for development, also perhaps for development cooperation. So I start with that, and then maybe later I'll talk about the Better Life for Girls and the new rural development scheme.
Okay. I'll come right back to you then. I'm going to ask Jiang to reflect a little bit on, you know, how the SDGs are really shaping China's development cooperation, South-South cooperation, which is long-standing, but has it has the strategies changed, as a result of the SDGs?
Yes, I think actually SDGs has already, to some extent, changed China's China's policy towards the policy of the international cooperation. And of course, there's something has already changed and some not changed, because we still think that China, although just now I mentioned from a recipient to a donor country, and but we still think that China to try to help the other developing country through the, we call it the channel of South-South cooperation. And we still think that North-South cooperation should be the main channel in terms of international development cooperation. But actually, because the situation has already been changed a lot, and China has already become the second largest economy in the world, so it's our responsibility to help the other developing country. And also we think that with the SDG in our mind, we need, when we talk about the aid, assistance, usually it's also something to do with the national interest. Why you aid the others? Because it fits your national interest. So interest, and for other things, is justice. You just help people for helping. And nowadays, we think that when we talk about international development cooperation, when we try to aid the others, we also know that there's something we call the national interest. But we think we should put the justice before interest. It doesn't mean there's no interest at all for us to help the others. Mm-hmm. But the most important thing is that we have to let the world to be justice, to let the people have a better life in the future. Mm. That's our the first change. Mm, and also, just now you mentioned that President Xi, he also initiated the $2 billion US dollars to help developing countries to implement the SDGs. But at the same time, also, we have diversified our help. For example, we will establish an international development knowledge center. That's something to do just like Koreans. We try to share our experience to our developing countries, to the other developing countries. And also, we will raise the investment to least developed countries. Up till 2030, there will be $12 billion US dollar directly invest to least developed countries to help them to lift the poverty, as well as according to a Chinese saying that through the investment, not only we just give them fish, but let them to know how to fish. So that's why we think the investment is so important to those least developing countries. And also, because of the SDGs and China has its commitment to implementing SDGs, so we think that we should try to integrate our aid to the developing country into the three dimensions. So a presidency issued the, we called the 6-100 initiatives. And that 6-100 initiatives includes the poverty reduction program, the aid and trade program, environmental and the climate change, coping with environmental and the climate change program, as well as 100 program for setting up a clinic and a hospital, and 100 schools, so and 100 agriculture project in developing countries, mainly in African countries. So now you see, previously maybe we won't support developing countries in terms of coping with climate change, but now we think it's quite important that we have to support them through the 100 project in terms of coping with climate change as well as environmental protection. That's also the change. And the third one, just now you mentioned the security issue and peace and security. Of course, I do think that Chinese government don't think that we need to set a goal we call peace and security. But we agree with that, inclusive this, the goal, SDG goal 16, peaceful and not security, inclusive and peaceful society. And we support this. But we do not think that we have to interfere the other countries' inner affairs. But we can try to support peace and security through the international organizations or regional organizations like AU, like United Nations. So that's why, actually, China will stress on the importance of peace and development in implementing Goal 16. For example, China, I just give you some example. To 2020, China will train 2,000 peacekeepers from other countries, mainly from African countries. And also, China will provide $100 million to the African Union and will provide free military aid through the $100 million to the African Union. And also, China will build a peacekeeping standby force of 8,000 troops. And actually, up to now, China is the largest country provide peacekeeping troops in the Permanent Five, but not in all those member states of the United Nations. So that's why we link peace and security with the development issue. So that's why I think China has already changed a lot our international development cooperation strategy because of the SDGs. Thank you.
That's very interesting, actually, to hear about that shift, which seems quite substantial as a result of the SDGs, both in terms of kind of philosophy and also in terms of the projects. It's a real diversification from the past, I think, for China. Unmi, if you wouldn't mind, I'd like to introduce the audience a little bit to the Better Life for Girls initiative. We're having a bit of problem with graphics there.
Right.
So.
Oh,
yeah, do you need the graphic? Can you do it without?
I can do without.
Okay. Not sure how to fix it.
Yeah. President Park Geun-hye was very proud to be at the UN meeting last year, September 2015. She went through quite a few panels and was an important figure in giving one session the Korean government organized, a new rural development paradigm. So there were two programs among many that she introduced that were very significant. One is the new rural development paradigm, but the other one was the Better Life for Girls initiative. And maybe I will start with the Better Life for Girls initiative because this is something that I had been working on and providing the research findings from my research. So I was very happy when the president took the initiative. Said, wow, she took this. And I was really flabbergasted, very pleasantly surprised. The Better Life for Girls initiative started with a grant that I received from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation asking us to find something that the Korean government can do in global public health. Because our development cooperation isn't very big and we weren't really doing much, spending quite a bit of our ODA funds in public health issues, but not really, didn't have any specific, distinct, or important initiatives. So they asked us if we can do something about it. After looking at what Korea had done well in our public health, we're probably number one in the world in terms of family planning. I mean, we did so well that we're now below replacement and one of the most rapidly aging societies in the world. When we do something, we do quicker than anybody else. So we did development in one generation, eliminated poverty in one generation, but we also, you know, our babies are not coming. So, and we're the fastest aging population in the world. So we looked through various things that we were doing, and then we looked through what Korea was doing in the global public health area. The most of the largest amount of money we were spending was building hospitals and health centers, health clinics. We were doing WASH projects in sub-Saharan Africa and so on, but nothing really that stood out, nothing that really reflected our own experience and whatnot. And then we started looking at, through the MGG's report, to see what was missing in the global public health field. And among the eight goals, goal number four, infant mortality, and goal number five, maternal health, were the most problematic in terms of reaching their goals. Throughout the eight goals, they were all very problematic in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, but four and five were universally pretty much in jeopardy. So we started looking at that. And when we did more research about how to improve maternal and child's health, we realized that the intervention from the United Nations and all the donor countries were happening too late. There were young girls at the age of nine who were getting pregnant and giving birth. I mean, it's horrible that these young children are giving birth, and there are a lot of repercussions on these young girls who are so become mothers at such a young age for their own health as well as the health of the infant and the babies. And the reasons why these young girls were getting pregnant, as you know, is not just for medical, for their own consent. It could sometimes be by religion, culture, social norms. Poverty has a big role to play. Sexual violence, and so on. So we looked at this mix of packages affecting young girls whose needs were not being addressed. So we decided to look into what are the health risks for young girls, and what can we do to help remedy those young girls from getting pregnant at such a young age and having all these health risks, but as well as social and educational risks. So at the end, we decided to focus on young girls from the age of nine. This is a WHO guideline, from nine to before 18 as a critical vulnerable years for young girls in developing countries, and in order to assist them with their comprehensive health issues, it was really about education as well as health. So that's why the Better Life for Girls initiatives talks about educating these girls so they know more about their rights and responsibilities, but can really protect themselves and perhaps become a major actor in changing their own lives as well. And some research in sub-Saharan Africa showed that for young boys to reduce HIV/AIDS infection is by providing them with condoms and good sex education, but for girls in high gender gap societies, that doesn't work. So for girls, it's just sending them to secondary schools was the best remedy to help with HIV/AIDS. So the more research we're doing, we're finding that education in and of itself can be a cure for illnesses as well as for empowering them. So the Better Life for Girls initiative became a very comprehensive initiative to assist young girls who are sort of becoming a lacuna in terms of development assistance in MCH in particular. So the Better Life for Girls initiative was born, and we presented to the government, but really wasn't thinking that the government would really actually take note of our research. We were flabbergasted, I mean, very pleasantly, mind you. But we were very pleased when the government announced that they were going to put $200 million from 2016 to 2020 for this initiative, and announced 15 countries that we see that were going to be target countries for this aid. So this is a new initiative. And along with the Better Life for Girls, they've created a much more comprehensive Better Life for All initiative. So various sectors, we have the Better Life Initiative. And I look forward to working with my government to do the right thing on this and hoping that many other governments, countries will join in this initiative. So.
Thanks. Great. Julia, I don't know if you want to add anything from the Australia perspective. I'm going to segue into the last question so you can have a double-barreled question and answer both together if you like. Reflect a bit on Australia and what the SDGs will mean in terms of Australia's development cooperation, but then also, will they provide opportunities for countries like Australia to work more with China and Korea and the non-traditional providers? Often, people say there's a lack of convergence between the non-traditional providers and the traditional providers, and we struggle to find areas of convergence. Will the SDGs provide a platform for more convergence and working together?
Yeah. Well, you know, what might the SDGs mean for Australia's Development Cooperation Programme? You know, our Development Cooperation Programme has just been through these massive wrenching changes, you know, unprecedented levels of cuts, and the entire bureaucracy which administered the aid programme was abolished, and it's been taken over by DFAT. So I think it's not surprising that it's difficult to see, you know, at the first point of that, you know, as the aid went into DFAT, there was a whole process of developing aid investment plans, and then the second round of cuts came. And so, you know, I think that's had an impact on the ability of the official aid program to really respond to the SDGs, but you know, I would say it's still very early days in this 15 years, and it sounds, you know, from the rhetoric from the department and from the minister that there is an intention that this does influence the directions of the aid program. I have sort of listened to a few podcasts from people from USAID and so forth, and you know, and there is a sense in which everything we're doing relates to the SDGs, so it's okay. But I hope that, particularly as the indicators get agreed in March this year, that will give a sort of some impetus, and as we start to gather data globally on those indicators, some impetus to think about which areas we want to see most change in. But I would also say that for Australia, this is a particular challenge because, you know, the Minister's been very clear that the area of critical importance for Australia is the Pacific. And this is the area, you know, the Pacific has done really badly in terms of achievements against the MDGs. So, you know, I think high levels of Australian aid have not actually resulted in Pacific Island countries meeting the MDG targets. And I think, you know, there has been a big rethinking of our aid program, clearly. And so how will that set it up to be able to deliver on the SDGs? You know, I do think it's interesting when you say, is this a platform for greater cooperation? You know, for decades, Australia has dabbled with trilateral cooperation with Korea, with China, and I'm not sure any of it's been terribly big or terribly successful, but these global platforms do offer that opportunity. But I would also point that some OECD donors' rhetoric on aid has actually become much more aligned with the Korean and Chinese rhetoric. I was interested, I'm pretty sure it was the Dutch government saying, you know, our aid program is going to help the Netherlands economy from now on. You know, that was the most recent government. And I think, you know, Julie Bishop's commitment to economic diplomacy is clearly about Australia's economy as part of the region. So I actually think that that's an interesting shift in terms of changing global rhetoric around development cooperation. But, you know, we all have fairly complex bureaucracies with particular cultures. And it's one thing to bring two of those bureaucracies together in a bilateral relationship. When you make it a trilateral relationship, you have to start, you know, I mean, there can be big overheads in that. It is worth having fora like the DAC, which enable us and other fora to really exchange views and ideas. And I think it's a terrific idea to explore, but we do run the risk of making things even more complicated than they are.
Thanks. Jiang, what do you think? Do you think China, with the SDGs, will see more triangular cooperation that has meaning, or will we see China participate more in global policy fora?
Yes. I can just give you an example. Last year, our Prime Minister, our Premier, Li Keqiang, visited OECD DAC and delivered a speech over there. And another story that in 2014, in an international symposium organized by South-South Cooperation in Washington, D.C., organized by United Nations, we have a panel and with some scholars from India. And when I delivered this, I said that China should try to, how to say, cooperate with OECD, and we should try to promote the triangle cooperation, and so on and so forth. And the Indian scholar directly asked me, do you think the China's government will at last try to bid for the membership of OECD? But my response is that no, we will never ever be member of OECD, not like Korea. But it's quite important. We need to cooperate and we have a dialogue. And then the next year, that means last year in 2015, our premier visited OECD and delivered a speech. So I do think that during the period from the 2015 to 2030, China's position in the international development cooperation, that's my personal view, we can play the role as a bridge between the group 77 and maybe group 34, the OECD country. And of course, that's one thing. And why? Because I think China still a largest developing country in the world, but at the same time, so we have to be very responsible in the international development cooperation. And China can play this role as a bridge, but not as a member of the so-called the richest countries club. That's my personal view towards this. That's the first thing. And the second is that China still think that not only in the climate change, in environmental protection, as well as in international development cooperation, we should try to still abide by this principle we call CBDR, common but differentiated responsibility. China is a developing country, so we can provide our help to our developing country through the South-South cooperation or to some extent the triangle cooperation. But we still think that the Western country, the North country, they should try to commit it to the 0.7 of GNI in the ODA. And on the other hand, China is also very responsible in terms of the development aid. According to our white paper issued by our government in 2014, if I have not memorized wrong, according to my memorize, that from 2010 to 2012, the increase rate of the China's foreign aid, the rate is 20%. And according to my personal calculate, up to now we provide maybe 0.07% of our GNI in the foreign aid. And according to this increased rate, I think to 2030, maybe China's foreign aid, official foreign aid to the developing countries through the South-South cooperation, I think maybe we'll reach 2.1, but not 0.7. We never ever committed to that number. But even 0.1, this number, you just keep in mind, according to Kitty's this morning's presentation, maybe China's GDP will surpass the UN GDP. Then just imagine how huge the foreign direct foreign aid from China would be. And the third thing is that because China has already been a donor's country, but China still have 200 million extreme poverty population. How can we persuade people to understand that? The first thing first is that we have to eliminate our domestic extreme poverty and to achieve food security and provide health for all in our own country. So I think while we try to help the others, our government will think about how can we try to solve our own problem first, and then we have the solid base to help the others. So I think these two, the international development cooperation as well as domestic development in the terms of the three dimensions, integrated the environment, society, social, and as well as economic growth together, then we can provide help to the world. First, if China at last to 2030 can really eliminate 200 million extreme poverty in our country, then that's the most important contribution to implementing SDG in the world. At the same time, if we can provide maybe 0.1 percentage of our GNI in the foreign aid, then it will also be a great contribution. And I'm looking forward to 2030. Maybe at that time, I don't know where I will be, but I hope it will become the truth. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name's Helen Hill from Victoria University in Melbourne and also the National University of Timor-Leste in Dili. I'd like to thank the speakers. I mean, I'm very interested in the argument about the experience of development of those new donors influencing the way that their aid program operates. But it seems to me both China and Korea are huge countries. They followed an export-led model of industrialization. Most of the countries still in the aid program, with the exception of Africa, I realize Africa's different, but they're mostly small island states in the Pacific now, which are never going to adopt an export-led model of industrialization. And in fact, you know, when I used to teach this to my students, the Pacific, oh, no, no, we're never going to be able to do that. And I'd just like to make a quick example. There's another non-traditional donor which has been active in the Pacific, and that is Cuba. And ironically, Cuba received aid from Australia under the Howard government. The Cubans asked Australia to fund a permaculture project, and that was extraordinarily successful when the Cubans were facing an agricultural crisis. And just a few months ago, the Cubans have brought that agriculture they learnt from Australia to Timor-Leste, and it's being implemented in a cussie because Australia would never put permaculture in the aid program to Timor for some reason, but put industrial agriculture in the program to Timor. So I'm just sort of wanting to point out the sort of the different types of experience of development that different countries have.
Was there a question there? Thank you. There was a question there?
I was Nolina Bolivar from Diverse Voices in Action for Equality and Dawn from Fiji. My question, I was in all of the open working group meetings around the SDGs, and thank you, it was a really useful session. One of the questions that I have is, in that whole process where we did have so much civil society and government engagement trying to move to what is quite a complex set of SDGs, I'd like to hear your thoughts about the fact that while we have this, you know, focus on accountability and how we are accountable in terms of the social contract between states and their citizens, but also states and states, the question also is, how do we reconcile that with the fact of things like the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement and the TAFTA agreement that's on? So as you get a widening of free trade agreements, how are we going to reconcile that with human rights within states and between states? Thank you.
Thank you. Here? It's this one. Sorry, to point.
Just a really quick question for the whole panel, but potentially most particularly for Mr. Jiang. I'm wondering how you see the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank as sort of feeding into this SDGs in Asia. Is this something that potentially represents that new model, or is this for the time being something a little bit off to the side? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for those questions. So first, let's look at the relevance of China-Korea development model with small island states. I'd like to take that with me.
Let me start with that question. I mean, if you see Korea now, we seem like such a fairly affluent nation that it's not, our lessons are not applicable, and we're such an unusual case. But let me take you back to the early 1960s when we began our development experience. Our GNP per capita at the time was $81, so poorer than many of the sub-Saharan poorest countries in the world. We just were coming out of war that has officially not ended, so it's a war-torn country. We had no natural resources or gas or any other sort of mineral resources that we could really count on. We have very low levels of technology, so we didn't have any of the ingredients that were necessary for development, capital, technology, land, or whatever. Our land is the size of Minnesota. Our population is now about 50 million, so it's not a very big, big country that you might think of. So the obstacles or challenges that we face as an impoverished country is not very different from the developing or the least developed countries face. Poverty, extreme poverty, war and conflict, lack of democracy, all those things packaged into a nice bundle was South Korea. The World Bank officials were saying that we were a basket case. So, and now, Jim Kim, the Korean national born, is now the head of the World Bank, so irony. Anyway, so the point that I want to make is Korea's lessons should be valid, and when I was at the UN last year at the 70th anniversary, it really struck me and others that Korea was one of the very few countries that made from extreme poverty prosperity within a generation. So developing countries still come to us to ask us, so what did you do? What did you do that was different? What did you do that you didn't listen to your donors and so on? And my story is not about export-oriented industrialization. That was a strategy that we could use at the time. Mm-hmm. The strategy for us was we had a government that was able to bring all of the talent in the country to work on a development strategy that was best suited for us at the time. We wouldn't say that export is the only way. I don't think that's the only way these days. It's not a good way because the market is too crowded. But when Korea, without resources, without capital, the only thing we had going was a lot of people who are fairly well educated. So our level of education was much higher than countries at our level of poverty. So that's what we had. Smart, relatively smart people who were educated, not smarter, but well-educated people. So what we did is we couldn't just focus on our domestic economy because we had so little. So the only way that we thought we could earn money is through exporting light manufactured products. So throughout the 60s, the high on our export items were wigs. We were the global capital of wigs because our dark hair, we didn't have money to have perms and stuff like that. So it was untreated coarse hair that could be made into very good wigs. So we were the wig capital of the world. We were the capital of stuffed toys before China. So we were the global capital of cheap clothing, textiles. So that's where we started because that's the only thing that we could do. So the lesson from Korea is not exports. It's really about working through the government, having government leadership, and channeling all the resources into what we could do, given our challenges and given what we had. So I wouldn't say export is the answer, but I would really say working with a sound government. So I think that formula would be different. But the fact that we struggle through a war-torn economy, political strife, and poverty, these are issues that are not very different from developing countries who struggle these days. There are, of course, some lessons that we hope countries would not follow us. We had a long authoritarian rule we would not say, oh, go, hey, go ahead, go get a military dictator to Mosul. I would not recommend that. I would say to the contrary, these are things that you should not try to replicate. That's why we are very much into being transparent about both our successes, but also our trials and errors, so that other countries will not repeat some of the mistakes that we had done. But we hope that we can provide an alternative to what the Washington Consensus says. And so that's the message. That's the lesson that I would rather like to share.
Thank you. Jiang, could you comment on the relevance of the China model, and then maybe also jump straight into the link between the AIIB and the SDGs?
First of all, I don't think I will promote the authoritarian government in the old days in South Korea. But I will say that actually, if we really want to promote development and lift poverty, I think a strong government is very important. Not only me, but also Fukuyama also says so. Without a strong government, how can you really do something to help people to lift their poverty at all? So, of course, according to China's former leader, Deng Xiaoping's saying, that no matter it's a white cat or black one, if can catch the mice, it will be the good one. So no matter what kind of government, if those government is accountable one, if this those government can help people to lift poverty, then we just follow this. Maybe I cannot say China model. China people always say Beijing consensus or China model. But according to my personal experience, actually, I don't think China can be a so-called Washington consensus as a Beijing consensus. But one thing is quite important. Every country has their own situation. They have to select their own road to their own development. And up to now, I can say, through the more than 30 years opening up and reformation in China, we have found a right way for China to develop from a very, least developing country or less developing country to a, we call the middle income country, and even in the future, and from recipient to a donor country. So through this way, I think, maybe that's, if we can say China's model, that means you should try to find the best way for your own country. Maybe that's the answer for your question. And for AIIB, and in SDGs, we know the SDG Goal 9 said that build resilient infrastructures. Mm-hmm. So you can find the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. So that means infrastructure is so important, and just now we mentioned, and even in the morning, talked about China's aid to Africa. We aid a lot in those infrastructure construction. And in China's saying, if you want your country, I mean, the countryside, be rich, the first way is try to construct a road towards your village, and your village will be rich. The infrastructure is so important. But in the Asia-Pacific region, of course, we have World Bank, we have the Asia Development Bank, but they have no enough fund. And China have enough fund. And we have the capability to do that, and why not? That's why we initiate the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB. That's the first reason. And the second, I do think that this bank is very open towards the world. Australian government joined this, and also UK, except, I'm so sorry, United States and Japan, our good neighbor Japan. But anyway, I think in the future, maybe. I'm not sure. But this bank is still very open. And thirdly, I do think that AIIB, it is a mechanism, by an international development cooperation mechanism. It is the mechanism to implement the traditional one, like World Bank, like Asia Development Bank. I don't think that China or even like Australian government will think that we join it and we want to replace Asia Development Bank or World Bank. So that's why I think all the world should support AIIB, let it be successful and help the international cooperation in the future, specifically to complete the goal 9, build resilient infrastructure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I try to do a question number two?
Yes, question number two on, Julia, do you want to tackle that one on, and then I'll turn, Unmi'd like to say something as well.
Sure,
accessibility, accountability, human rights, and the TPP.
Well, you know, I think the SDGs have a, you know, important aspirations towards good government, good governance and participation, but there are some unfortunate trends in the world, even, you know, within our own government, where we see freedom of information requests are, you know, becoming more difficult and not always the level of transparency one desires. I think citizens will need to demand transparency and need to keep arguing for it. It's not something that governments will automatically provide, but again, things like the SDG provide another lever, another way in which we need to claim the rights we have as citizens.
Yeah. I think you raise a very important issue about accountability and rights-based approach to these topics. I think in each of our governments, there is some balance and there's some tension between development cooperation and our practices of free trade and so on. Within the Korean government, the Ministry of Strategy and Finance is very much interested in promoting further trade and further economic growth of Korea. On the other hand, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs want to do more in terms of providing more grant aid in line with SDGs and so on. Ministry of Finance and Strategy, although they're the one providing the funds, not always sure. Mm-hmm. So you can see in the real day-to-day life that there is this this tension between different ministries and their different mandates, and broadly speaking, the global arena, tension between these goals. I hope because the SDGs were to be inclusive and we were supposed to look at not just to assist developing countries, but to find pockets of poverty in developed countries to assist, that maybe developed countries will find a way to incorporate the principles of rights-based approach to development cooperation in their other policy areas, such as free trade and TPP and whatnot. So I hope SDGs can be that conduit for that, but realistically speaking, I'm not that optimistic.
I'll take two short questions.
As a question for the whole panel, alongside all of the stakeholder consultation globally around the SDGs has also been, can you hear me? Yeah. Been the conversation about reform of the UN and reform of the UN agencies. And so I'd just be interested in the panel's comments on how you see the effect of the SDGs on the reform of the, you know, one of the key global systems for actually implementing them, and whether that reform process will, whether you see it actually happening and carrying on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next question, yeah.
Yep, I'm Simon Pollock, working for the Department of the Environment, but this is very much my own question. Just when talking about an alternative to the Washington consensus in providing aid and focusing on infrastructure, could that then be seen as a way of furthering tied aid in a way that is favouring maybe advantages for your own country's infrastructure providers and providing, in a way, unfair leg up for national industrial companies to get gains in developing countries?
Okay. Who'd like to take the UN reform question? No one? Sorry.
It's hard.
Think about it. Start with the second question.
The alternative to the Washington consensus doesn't mean just about giving more aid for infrastructure. I think that's one of the things, but I would stress that it's really about government leadership rather than letting the private sector lead the process of development in a country, especially in an early stage of development when the other institutions are not well developed. I think it's really critical for a sound government to have good policies for its nation's development. So I would say when I mentioned alternatives to Washington consensus, I was more focused on the government versus the market divide rather than the infrastructure. Tied aid, no, I don't think that's such a good idea. I think looking at how aid projects are being provided in developing countries from the Korean government, sometimes it's much more economical to use vendors from neighboring countries than to use Korean companies or Korean products, and we have certainly done that. So untied aid, I think, is not really the tied aid is not the answer that I would say is part of the alternative to the Washington consensus. So, but I thank you for that question to give me a chance to clarify. Reform of UN agencies, I think that has been a very important goal for the Ban Ki-moon Secretary General from his first and his second. The one thing that I notice is minor, but maybe not minor, but he has been rather successful in bringing more women to the leadership, and I think that's making some changes. Not that all men are bad, but he is, of course, a man. But he has really included more women in the leadership, and I think that's making some changes within creating UN Women as a comprehensive women's initiative agency within the UN, I think, is a step in that direction. But I don't know to what extent the reform within the UN has been successful. I know there has been a lot of effort in trying to reform, but I don't know how far they've gone and whether they've been really successful.
When we talk about the Washington consensus, but actually MDGs based on post-Washington consensus. So that means now maybe we are experiencing the period of post-Washington DC, but it doesn't mean that we return to Washington consensus. And at this moment, I think the most important thing that the whole world, because SDG is a universal one, it's a comprehensive one, and it's also a transformative one. That means, according to China's experience, that we are reaching the stage that we have to transform our economic structures and so on and so forth. I think even in at world large, in this world, we are now experiencing how can we transform the traditional economic growth to the three dimensions. That means we promote economic growth sustainably, sustained, and but also we should protect the environment and to promote social development. And then it will be not only beyond the Washington consensus, but also beyond the post-Washington consensus. Then we can really implement the SDGs in 15 years, but I doubt we can really fully implement all those goals, because just now I mentioned there's too many targets and then indicators. In March, I can really difficult to imagine how many indicators. It's difficult. And for us, my personal job, maybe we try to suggest maybe every country should try to find something which we can really implement quite well. And then we can at the same time try to implement all of those goals and so on so forth, targets and so on and so forth. About the UN reform, I can just maybe use China's experience. Just now I mentioned why China can develop so fast, because we experienced more than 30 years reformation as well as opening up to the world. So for us, reformation or reform, it's a continuous process. That means even in the largest international organization, I do think that it should experience a long, long time reformation. That means first we need to reform the structure, we need to reform the mechanism and all those systems in United Nations. But the second, just like Chinese experience, we cannot change the system overnight. We have to be very patient. Maybe just because of Chinese history is so long, so we are very patient. And American history and maybe Australian history is so short. You always want to change everything overnight. So I think the best way is try to go to the middle. We can try to find the third way. Try to reform it, at the same time, be patient. Thank you.
Thank you. That brings us to the close of the session. Thank you for excellent questions. I'm sorry for those of you who didn't get to ask your questions. I'd just like to sum up saying I think we can see from the session that the SDGs really have been a catalyst for change in the realm of development cooperation, both for northern and southern providers or Asian or Western providers, both as a catalyst for change and as an area of potential convergence, both in the present and going forward. So I think some hope